been around for long gone here. Stole many man's souls of faith. I was around when Jesus Christ had his moment of doubt and pain. I made damn sure the pilot washed his hands and sealed his fate.
Very good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to another round of Friday Night Live with us, your Hantu buddies. Every Friday without fail, we are here. This is our second last episode, though. Next week will be our last episode for the season. We will come back soon, so hang in there. So today and next week will be very, very special. Thank you guys for joining us. It means so much to us that you guys are running your Friday along with the rest of us. My name is Eugene. We have Kim, and we have Sonia and Joe. Alvin, could you help to adjust Sonia's screen? I know she's already very vertically challenged, but now you make her look even shorter.
Excuse me.
Laughing with you, Sonia, not at you, with you.
Yeah.
And she looks a lot.
Yeah.
She looks very yellow, like jaundiced.
Saturated with what?
Excuse me, you all are really on some sort of a roll today. Saturated with?
Yeah. Huh? Not me. I did not say
Kim
anything.
Kim.
Anyway, I want to say that say that a suit brings confidence to a man. I would like to upgrade that statement to a Sony ZV-E10 camera with 4K streaming quality brings confidence to a man. No, not
is
yet.
Is this stream brought to you by Sony?
Okay, so
not yet. Okay.
What you are going to be experiencing tonight, as with every other Friday night, is real confessions from real people and real unscripted comedy from the rest of my co-hosts. I promise you guys, none of the shit that we made up tonight was ever scripted or planned. If you find it really funny, that's just because that's who we are. I know this is supposed to be a very scary story, and we really try to respect the sanctity of horror. Sometimes my co-host says the darnest stuff, and that makes it into becomes a meme. So thanks to Joelle, the rest of the regulars who are watching us right now and is always supporting us. Thank you so much for constantly being our pillar of strength. What do you guys? You guys want to say anything? I know Sonia just rushed home. She was just back like Jess.
Yeah. I had to get the kids at home to prep for me so that when I walk through the door, straight away, put everything up and sit down. Murphy's Law evenings for me.
So what happened? I mean, where were you?
I went urbexing. Can't say exactly where. So I was in an abandoned building. Let's just put it that way. Taking my pictures as usual. Okay, so I had a headache in there. I think that's noteworthy because I'm usually SE Recon's barometer, and I had a headache in the switch room. No, it's the place is abandoned, so no power.
Okay.
Yeah, so I had a headache in that one, and then as I was leaving, I got stuck behind a truck that couldn't get out of the car park for 15 minutes. So. It was just one thing after another, and it just so happened that every single traffic light was red as I rushed home.
Something's trying to prevent you from doing a short run. Well, our usual funny man Kim seems to be unusually quiet today. What happened?
No lah, because there's a part of me that I don't wanna. The more I talk, the more shit I spill about myself. So I'm gonna keep as much content to myself, you know, because there's so many things about me is already on the SC page. So I'm gonna.
I saw your post today. You know, telling everybody to log on at 10.
That was quite a
deceptive picture, I must say.
I'm not gonna comment further. I'm not gonna comment further. For those who wanted to see, maybe just head over to my Facebook. I think
that's quite an impressive puppy.
Yeah, right. Mm. So yes, puppy it is a puppy. It haven't been taken down from Facebook, so it is a puppy.
It's huge and veiny. That's the first thing I saw. The puppy, of course.
Kim, I have to ask a question, bro. What was the fallout from last Friday night's Supernatural Confessions towards the end?
What do you mean?
Because what was the fallout with your mom? Was there any phone calls? She watched the show. Was there a phone call? Was there? Because maybe that's why you're quiet tonight, because mommy's watching.
I'm not sure whether she's here now. But yeah, I'm having dinner with her tomorrow, lah. So
to have the talk, is it?
I'm not sure.
Mommy's gonna sit you down and
finish.
My girlfriend is coming with me, so I have a backup, like in case I got slaughtered or something.
Never let the two women come together because they'll gang up against you.
Oh, then and F my life, lah. It's been a great journey with you guys, lah. Yeah. See you on the other side.
And Joseph Dakota, he started off with just, guys, I'm just going to do once a month because I really don't have the time. Yeah. But then, he's been doing this every week. I just quietly sitting here not wanting to rock the boat. What happened, bro? We are coming to the end of the season. I mean, you obviously started off with one show, then two. And what happened?
I think it was because I no longer have a night shift during the week, so it opened up more time. And I think after that, I think Supernatural Confessions is like a drug. Like, I keep coming back for more.
It just kind of... You want to say me, is it? I'm your drug, is it?
Oh,
of course. Oh. That's why we're going to that hotel room when the borders open up, Kim. But I'm a little bit upset today. My daughter, she came up and asked me for a bookmark. And you know, she's 12 years old and she still doesn't know my name.
Daddy Dakota.
No, no, she came and asked me for a bookmark.
Oh,
she's 12 and she doesn't...
Hiya, that one felt flat, la.
No, well, that felt very flat. That felt very flat. Yeah.
Tough crowd.
It just feels like you're throwing the book at me, Sonia.
Tough crowd.
Let me see what I have to throw at you.
So Joseph Mark Dikota today is our featured host for our featured confession. You see him ever come online or come on screen to conduct interviews or provide confessions. But if you remember, and you've been following us for some time, the last few confessions that Joseph sent us were really spooky. There's the one with the cat. Remember the gin cat?
Oh, that was creepy.
Then there's the EVP that was caught in the funeral parlor. Right? And now we're looking forward to today's one, which is about a creature in Indonesia, an unseen village. So I've not watched it yet. I'm going to watch it with the rest of you guys and be equally surprised.
That'd be awesome. And you know what? Hopefully we have more things planned towards the end of the year. Keep it as a surprise, but I won't say much about that.
Sure. There's some of you who was asking us, can we go back to Facebook? What I intend to do is not to just go back to Facebook, but I want to be able to have dual streams. So people who prefer Facebook, you guys can go to Facebook and watch it. Those who want on YouTube, you can watch it on YouTube. In fact, I'm ready with two monitors. I will be able to answer both Facebook and YouTube at the same time. So all that coming up in season three, we're going to make some changes. I also want to say a big thank you and a shout out to two very important fans of our show. I was out with Sonia yesterday because we were filming the final chapter for one of the shows that we've been doing for Cathay and Lowy Pro. And in fact, Fazil and Serena Sim both bumped into us and they came up to us and said, hello, we love the show. And you know what? Thank you so much for making our day. Sometimes it's to hear stuff like this from you guys that really keeps us motivated and inspired to do what we do week after week. So thank you to Fazil and Serena.
Yes, thank you very much, but also quite scary.
Why?
Oh.
Yeah, I mean, it is quite scary because when people look at you twice, then you wonder, you know, why? Why are they looking at me like that? And it's until they actually come up to you and say, oh, I know you from Supernatural Confessions. Okay, then it makes sense. Yeah. Otherwise, I'm going to be wondering, did I spill something on myself? Or do I have a grain of rice somewhere? You know, why are they looking at me?
I remember this one time I was in, I think, Ashton's, eating my Western food. And I was wearing this Supernatural Confessions t-shirt. And on the next door, I see all these girls looking over, giggling to themselves. You know, so, yeah. Then after that, they started talking about ghost stories at their table. I go, okay. I think I know.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Or do any of you get like the stares that look at you and you go, stare, what stare? Do you get that kind of like...
As in, we stare at people or people stare at us and we go, stare, what stare?
Yeah.
No, you never go stare, what's there. In fact, usually when people look across, I just wave and I smile. I just assume that anyone who stares, who looks my way, is either a fan of the show, or at the very least, if he doesn't like me and I wave and say hello, I might just avoid getting bitten up. So either way, it works. All right, Kim, what do you have for us today?
Again, I want to ask the jokes or the cerita hantu.
Well, we always begin with the jokes. Let us not break tradition.
Joe started with a joke already.
Yeah, Joe started with a.
I done my joke. You know? I'm done.
But it fell flat. We need something to make us laugh.
Okay. I'll try. The other day, I went for an interview. Then the interviewee actually asked me, "Can you perform under pressure?" I say no, but I can try Bohemian Rhapsody.
I get it. Can you perform Under Pressure? Dun 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 dun.
And he says no, but I can try Bohemian Rhapsody. Now that we have explained the joke to you, is it funnier?
Okay, really. I wanna say whoever don't get the joke, you are too young, lah. But for Joe,
yeah, I'm quite young. In my middle 30s, in my early to mid 30s.
Okay, okay. All right. Tonight we have the confession that we're gonna have is I'm gonna go straight to confession. I'm not gonna leave the joke behind, huh? Okay, so tonight we have something to do with a crystal ball. A family had an experience with crystal ball. So I believe there are a lot of us would actually have a say, maybe something to do with jade, a crystal ball, an amulet, or something like that, right? So this is something that happened to a family. Then after that, we're going to have a story from a tuition center. I'm not sure whether it happens to us, but I do not know why, but this story leads to my segment of Know Your Hantu for this week.
And although, as a tribute to Sonia, right?
Yeah.
A tribute to me, why?
I'm not going to answer. I'm not. Oh my God, I nearly fell into the trap. Goodness God.
Sonia, you just have to stay tuned to find out why is it a tribute to you. But it's a tribute to you for sure.
Okay.
Sonia, I have nothing to do with this. I have nothing to do with this at all.
Should I be afraid or what? What's going on? What are you guys up to?
No.
Oh, I know. Just because I wasn't around for the
Hantu. Not that one, no? Sorry.
I wasn't around for the sound check. You all cooked up something while I wasn't around.
Maybe. No.
We wouldn't do something like that.
Yeah. If there are some cooking, it is gonna be Eugene that cook. Then we just follow only because he's the boss, makan. So no, it's not. We don't cook together.
Boss, me under.
Okay, then the last one, we're gonna have a confession from an anonymous from Mount Alvernia. So as somebody that is not from Singapore, then you guys gotta tell me more about this particular place. So then also I would like to take this opportunity to thank Kara Wong.
Kara Wong,
you write a lot of stories for us and also voice some of our stories before. But because due to her time, she says she preferred to write. So there are some stories that need some cleaning. So yeah, we pass it to her so that she can do a little bit of editing before we narrate it. We pass it to the narrators to narrate.
Oh, but whenever you... Okay, never mind.
She's going to rip-pen you today. Anyway,
yeah.
So let us start the show proper, kick it off with our very first confession for tonight. This one is called Saved by Crystal Ball. And it's confession by Jason Chu and voice over by Desmond.
Matt Rabin,
take it away.
Saved by Crystal Ball by Jason Chu. A friend of mine shared this story with me. It happened to his son, who's studying it in a local primary school. I will not reveal which school, as it is still functioning. His son stayed overnight in school for 3 days camp. In the wee hours, he woke up to pee and was walking out of his classroom towards the restroom. As he walked along the corridor, he saw a lady standing at the fourth level of the building. He was wondering who could that be, for it was the witching hours. As he was walking and staring at the figure, the lady looked at him, gave him a grin, and jumped, landing on the ground below. My friend's son was so shocked that he fainted. His teachers found him unconscious and brought him to the staff room. Teachers then attended to him and informed his parents. When he woke up, he cried and refused to say what had happened due to shock. My friend brought him home and after calming him down, his son then told him the whole story. For the next few days, his son had a fever and he would wake up in tears. My friend then called his feng shui master the next day. He bought a crystal ball from the feng shui master earlier for good luck, and so he consulted him on this. The master quickly went to his home, and he told my friend to look at the crystal ball placed near the front door. My friend and his wife, who were already too preoccupied with their son's crying and fever, looked on with shock that the crystal ball, which was initially intact and had a light yellow color, had now turned black and had a crack in the middle. The master immediately did some rituals in the house and took the crystal ball away to dispose of. He told my friend and his wife that the spirit his son had seen that night had followed his son home, but she was stopped by the chi energy from the crystal ball that was placed near to the front door. His son started to recover from his fever. The master told my friend never to let his son stay overnight in the school again. My friend listened to his advice and would never let his son stay in school after 5 p.m. for CCA. He then heard from his friends that the school used to be one of those sites used by the Japanese soldiers for interrogation during World War II. This could have explained the strange occurrence.
Okay, I'm gonna need to take over because obviously the screen is blank.
But we can hear you, we just can't see you.
Yeah, I'm not sure whether the rest of the people can hear Eugene or not, but Eugene is off.
Check. Testing.
Yeah, hearing him is fine.
Okay, so while we are waiting for Eugene to fix that, we have a story that came from Jason Chu about a crystal ball that kind of saved the sun from bumping into something worse. So, and now Eugene is completely gone.
Yeah, I think he's going to try and log back in. So,
yeah, so it seems like now tonight, I'm not sure whether, but we're going to start with the two super rational versus one. Okay. Do you want to take this first, Sonia?
Yeah, well, I was going to say that when it comes to crystal cracking, this is quite a common occurrence. If you are into crystals and the healing properties of crystals, you have to understand that crystals have it's got a very stable energy frequency that doesn't change very much. So it is used in watches to keep time, to power. It's a source of energy. Okay, basically it's a very stable source of energy. And there are things like fissures and cracks that naturally occur in crystals that can cause it to split open and crack. I'm just wondering, hearing this story, could that have been what caused this crystal ball to crack? Its inherent fissures and points of weaknesses in the crystal itself. It does happen. And, you know, if you understand the physics of it and the resonant field of that energy, a larger form of energy or a frequency could cause a crystal to crack, especially if it's along a fissure or a weak spot in it.
Hmm. Okay. So you are not debunking the story this time. You are not debunking this.
What I'm saying is, I'm trying to say that the reason that the crystal ball could have even cracked in the first place, because I know what you guys are going to say. You're going to say that it took the hit for something supernatural, right? Because you all believe that it's that first layer or that first layer of protection. It takes the hit or protects the person. It protects the person that it was for. I'm saying that the crystal ball could have cracked for other reasons.
Ah, okay.
Joe?
Can't hear you, Joe.
Joe can't hear you.
Can you hear me now?
Yeah.
Yes.
Okay, sorry about that. I had my mic off. Yeah, I think as per usual, Sonia took the words right out of my mouth. I was going to suggest cracks as well. But look, we can also go from the perspective of this is what we can call attribution of causality, that just because something happened after something happened doesn't mean that thing caused it.
Yeah, okay? So you don't always have to attribute it to that.
Exactly. You know, I think it's, you know, I mean, I know that the master, the guy had initially bought the crystal ball from the master. The master asked him to check on it. He's seen a crack. And then therefore the explanation is, you know, the energy came in there, and as Sonia said, it kind of took a hit, you know, what the boys are going to say. And what would have happened if, right, he checked the crystal ball and there was no crack in it? The alternative explanation could have been, oh, you know what, the crystal ball absorbed the energy, so everything's okay. So no matter what, you will never have an explanation that's not supernatural if that is something.
What if the crack was already there and they didn't examine it, you know, carefully in the first place, and it was only after then they figured, okay, now let's have a closer look at it, and it just so happens to be there? Because did they say they examined the crystal ball when they first received it? No, right? That wasn't mentioned.
They did not mention that part, but they did mention that because of what happened to the kid, they kind of like they forgotten about the crystal ball until the master actually mentioned the crystal ball. Then they went back to check on it. I mean, like before when they purchased it, they did not mention whether there's cracks or there's, you know, the color is different. That was not mentioned, but you know, when the kid falls sick, yeah, that of course they did not go and go and look at the crystal ball. Go and look at the crystal ball. It changed, you know, because the kid is already sick.
Yeah.
And also remembering that crystal balls may not necessarily be made out of crystal.
Someone said it's made out of glass.
Yes. It could be made out of acrylic or you know, a combination.
You know why? Because you know, and it also depends on the size. It's not easy to find a crystal that large.
Yeah.
And if you, for me, whenever I travel, whenever I hike, I tend to find crystals on my walks. I have found quartz. Yes, I have. And so I'm quite, for some funny reason, I'm quite in tune with crystals and I'm attracted to certain crystals. My favorite is rose quartz. And I tend to find it. I tend to find it on my walks. I tend to find it and a lot overseas. And it tells me a lot about the geology of the place. And you need a lot of high pressure mountain ranges and that kind of system in order to find crystal. So I end up finding a lot. And it's very difficult to find something large. So to have a pure crystal ball that size, I mean, a traditional crystal ball, the kinds that you see in movies where, you know, readers use, it's very difficult to find one that large.
I remember going on, sorry, keep going. Sorry, Eugene.
No, I'm thinking, could the confessor have mistaken crystal for crystal ball? I would imagine nobody walks around with a crystal ball these days, but people will walk around with an amethyst or a black tourmaline. But because the confessor didn't know how to describe one from the other, everything's a crystal ball. And then we always, when someone says crystal ball, I think of a gypsy around a ball telling your fortune, right?
Yeah.
And so the part about whether it's going to be cracked when they bought it, I'm making this assumption here that when they bought the crystal, they would have checked it, right? But you are right that it may have cracked along the way. There may be bumps, there may be wear and tear. However, that being said, there's also the possibility of a supernatural attack based on the many different anecdotal evidence that we have. Even some of our fans are actually saying they have experience, like Jimmy Lee, regarding this crystal petal bursting. I think like KK Hing as well, they are discussing about crystals taking a hit. And if you have been part of this show for some time, you know there's one particular story that I shared a while back where friends and myself were playing basketball on a weekend in the school compound, and then we started hearing chanting sound. And for no reason, we were not thinking of anything at all. We were playing, kids playing basketball. We suddenly felt fear, and we turned to look at each other, and we ran. And what someone's pendant just shattered. That's not the only one. Even grandmothers, people of our previous generation, they will always say, "Wear jade. Jade protects you." And grandmas and grandfathers swears by that protection. In fact, when you are born, especially for the Chinese, it is a common practice for grandparents to bestow a jade bangle onto the grandson or the granddaughter as a symbolic protection. So there is that belief in that. So I'm not sure whether this exact scenario would fall into Hantu or not. But then based on just the information that we have, it could just be 50-50 depending on your belief.
Yeah, because previously in previous episode I did share the similar, but mine was a story of a brother-in-law of a friend that he wore a pendant which is it kind of looked like a tiger stripes, right? Mm-hmm. So yeah, whenever he obtained it, of course the person who sell it to him say that it would protect you. So he met into an, I remember he was saying this story whereby he met an accident, and it was a very, very bad accident. Then the car was total loss, but he made out with just minor cuts. But when he actually looked back at the jet that he was wearing, the jet now it's in white color. So yeah, of course then he believed that, you know, the jet actually saved or did something good.
What I love about superstitions, right, is even though we don't have any scientific backing and proof of all this protection, but Asian being Asian, do you want to take the risk or do you just want to Oh man, I don't really believe it, but I'm just going to wear a jet anyway, just in case.
Yeah.
It's, right. It's like, you know, you're a single guy, you just bring a condom in your pocket just in case you get lucky. You know, you may not have to use it, but just in case.
Wow, I've never heard that. Yeah, I've never heard that too.
I don't know what you're talking
Eugene
about.
Eugene goes bareback, so I don't carry condoms in my wallet.
But it came out from you.
I heard. My friends say.
Your friends say. Okay. Okay. Since we are talking about crystal ball, can I slip in another joke? But we already started with another joke. But I just want to slip in anyway because I already mentioned it. Just now I was out jogging in a park, right? And I saw 100 men naked with their balls hanging. But it's a ballpark figure, like it could be more, I'm not sure, but it's a ballpark figure. I'm gonna laugh at my own joke.
He laughing at his own joke was funnier than the joke itself.
Okay, from the crystal ball, the ball part, then we can move on to something.
Okay.
I got the connection, but you know.
I mean, that joke was just hanging and I couldn't really.
Oh, okay.
Okay.
Sorry. Testes, 1, 2, 3, can you hear me?
Yeah.
Testes. Okay, sorry. I thought my mic had gone off.
Oh, hear you running here, bro.
No worries. Thanks, guys.
We have a Nick's confession. This one, oh my goodness, this one is also a tribute to Sonia Corona.
What now?
This one is confessed by Hei Chi Lian and voice over by Bella Sher, titled Little People. Take it away, Alvin.
What the?
I've always known that my workplace was not clean. And what I encountered today was one of the many reasons why. My workplace is located in a neighborhood shopping mall, and it's always bustling with people from all walks of life. I've been working here for the past 3 years and have heard some stories, but nothing out of the ordinary happened. Until today. I was teaching a night class from 6 to 8 p.m. when the secondary school students told me that something did not feel right and were feeling scared. I thought they were simply being silly or paranoid, and possibly due to the many Hantu stories we shared in class, or that they're just trying to scare me, so I didn't pay too much attention. Sometime later, one of the students went to the bathroom at 7 p.m, but he quickly came back and told me he had been spooked by some weird drafts or noises in the bathroom. I reassured him and told him it was nothing, and carried on with a lesson. About 7:30 p.m, the same student told me the corridor lights had been switched off. I found that to be quite odd, as I knew I was the only teacher and staff left at the center, so I went out to check. The moment I stepped out of the classroom, I heard a distinctive click from the area where the light switch was, and lo and behold, the lights were turned back on. As soon as my eyes adjusted, my gaze fell upon a small black shadow, about 150 cm tall, that quickly whisked away into the corridor that was next to the light switch. Oh my god, I thought to myself. I could feel static in the air and goosebumps appeared in my arms. I knew I was not hallucinating. What was fear at first quickly turned into irritation. 可以不要这样吗? Well, I even tried to communicate with whatever that was. On hindsight, I think I was trying to be brave and protect my students. I then quickly went back into the classroom. My students overheard me and thought I was talking to them. I shrugged it off and hurriedly finished off the last 30 minutes of class before letting the students pack up to go home. Three of them huddled together and sped towards the exit. One of them called out to me with a "Chuh! I'm gonna bring some joss papers and holy water to class next week." What considerate students they are. But I hope it doesn't happen again.
Oh, and like that.
Are we done?
That's why. I felt like I was
left hanging.
Oh,
wow. I was waiting for the rest of it. It's like, where's the rest of the story?
Exactly.
No, that's all. Okay. Because while we were playing the confession, the height was mentioned, right? So it's 150 centimeter in height. And one of our co-hosts mentioned saying that, you know, it's not a lot shorter than that person was. Yes, so yes. I want to know from the audience, how tall is everybody? Please put in your height in the comment.
Joe Kex.
I want to know.
Yeah, 150.
Like,
yeah.
Joe
don't
say
call me little
yeah.
people, lah, he says. So putting.
Oh, no, just don't piss off Sonia today. She's got a really short temper. So
L is 1.51 L. She's 1.51.
So you see, 150 cm is 1.5 meters. And when they mentioned that 150 cm is short, it got me thinking. No, it's not short. That's 1.5 meters. That's only 5 cm shorter than I am. So.
Okay. People are saying 160 centimeter, 154 centimeter.
Guys, it's not the height that matters. Okay, it's the width.
The girth. Oh, sorry.
The girth, what? Yeah. Girth is
the girth.
Dude, I'm not talking about that, bro.
Oh, sorry.
What show am I on?
Yeah. Okay. Actually,
I
want to give you guys a quiz on this one because I'm very interested to find out what you think about us. Obviously, when you see us on screen, guys, all you watching us right now, you only see this part, right? So all of us could be however height we want to be, but you will never know. Just to satisfy my curiosity, could you key in what the hell?
Sonia lah.
Show me some more little people. I show you.
Saka. Saka.
I show you my little knife. Okay. Little people.
Oh, I know why my camera keeps turning off by itself. Anyway, could you ask them to enter our height? What do you think? How tall we are? All
I already said my height.
WSA says Eugene 175 cm.
Eugene is 175 cm, okay.
What is this? Joe looks short. Hey! Who you being? Jangan anyhow tembak.
Okay, so Eugene is still not back on. It came back with Kimi is 175, Joe is 180. Sonia is 155.
145 was it? 155. Oh, sorry.
I already mentioned what just now.
No, you're not. When you mentioned, it's when the story is playing, so they know, and we know they don't know.
No, I said it also. I said I'm only 5 cm taller than the height in the story. It's simple math.
Okay, sorry.
Kang J I H. I've got someone saying that I look like I'm above 160. It's the larger than life personality, isn't it?
What do you mean Joe is a grizzly bear height and width? What are you trying to say?
You
I'm
are
not that fat.
Andre the Giant, lah. It looks like Andre the Giant.
Thank you, dear Vicky. Joe looks petite. Yes, I am.
Okay, Ray say I'm short but I got big feet. Okay. Oh, I like this one. Sonia is a bit taller than Danny DeVito.
For a woman being short, I think it's still quite okay. We get away with it, but for a guy, I think it's a little bit tough being short.
Excuse me, guys, we are commenting on the height, not on my size. What do you mean Joe looks big size for his height? What is happening?
Let me say, if you can be short, right? It's all about proportion.
I thought it was about performance, the way you use it.
No, it's right now, I'm talking about proportion here, okay? So you can be short, but if you are stumpy, then that doesn't look quite right. But if you're petite in every way, and, you know, I think that works.
And when you're big way, matters, it's perfect. Anyway, moving on.
Excuse me?
I still can't get my screen to work, guys. I got a kick-ass camera, but it's not working. That's what's worse.
Mm-hmm. It was working fine just now.
Yeah, stop bully Joe. That's correct, Shafiq Roubaix. Stop bully Joe.
Oh, somebody said, would you date a taller woman? Guys, this one is for you. Would you date a taller woman?
Yeah, for sure.
My ex was 6 foot woman. One.
Ooh!
You see, you've not revealed your height yet. I still don't know how tall you are.
To be really honest, I don't know how tall I am.
Can you estimate? Oh.
Estimate? I don't know. I'm...
So we know that you are shorter than... than 6'1", because that's how tall
your
friend was. So you're shorter than 6'1".
A friend of mine is 6 foot. I am a little bit shorter than him.
Oh.
I'm about that much shorter than him.
Mm.
Okay.
So what's the guesstimate?
I don't know.
Okay.
You? What about you, Kim?
Me? What? Would I date a tall
lady?
No.
How tall are you first?
I'm 6 feet.
You mean this way?
I'm six feet six inches, but it's not together.
Ooh. My man.
That's just TMI right there.
Okay. Eugene.
Oh, do that. Yes. Yes. That why is the am way. That is called the Along of SC. Oh no, that is lovely. I love that pic.
Oh, he's back on.
What is my
record doing there?
I got bad news for you all. I got bad news for myself.
What's happening?
My Sony ZV-E10 is not working, so I'm back to using my Logitech 1080 camera.
Oh no!
It's okay, bro.
So bad. It's better than having your picture just now. That one, okay?
Yeah. Hey, don't I got. I look quite badass. You know? Anyway, so
it's just bad. No F.
Okay. Tonight we gotta
I felt that from all over here. Yeah, I felt
gotta,
that.
We gotta put the body shaming aside. We gotta go back to the confession. You are straying way too far from the confession.
Sonia, you laugh. The next segment is also about you.
Oh, shit.
Know your hantu.
This week,
we'll be talking about orang pendek. I mean, take it away. Alvin, take it away now.
Alvin.
No, Mark, Alvernia later.
Now it's no
hantu in the middle, bro. Yeah.
In Indonesian folklore, there is a creature said to inhabit remote mountainous forests on the island of Sumatra named Orang Pendek. The creature had been seen and documented as well for at least 100 years by different forest tribes, locals, and even Western colonists, scientists, and travelers. It is often seen by bipedal primate covered in short fur and standing between 80 to 150 centimeters in height. Suku Anak Dalam, nomads who have traditionally lived throughout lowland forests of Jambi and South Sumatra, mention in their legends Orang Pendek has been a part of their world and they had co-inhabited the forest for centuries. However, for Orang Rimba of Bukit 12, instead of Orang Pendek, they call them Hantu Pendek, which is translated to short ghost. But their description matches that of Orang Pendek. According to the Orang Rimba, Hantu Pendek travel in groups of 5 or 6, feeding on wild yams and hunting animals with small axes. And Orang Rimba are often told by their ancestors that Hantu Pendek are cunning yet dim-witted creatures. As for Dutch colonies, I quote Mr. Van Heerwoorden, who described an encounter he had while surveying land in 1923. I discovered a dark and hairy creature on a branch. The creature was also hairy on the front of its body. The color there was a little lighter than on the back. A very dark hair on its head fell to just below the shoulder blades, or even almost to the waist. Had it been standing, its arm would have reached to a little above its knees. They were therefore long, but its leg seems to me rather short. I did not see its feet, but I did see some toes which were shaped in a normal manner. There were nothing repulsive or ugly about its face, nor was it at all ape-like.
Sonia, is it true that the Orang Pendek are foragers? Is it true? Or
yeah.
Did they move in packs, Sonia?
Are you asking if I paid attention to the story? Yes, I did. 80 to 150 cm, Orang Rimba talk about them being cunning but daft at the same time, which I didn't get because that's an oxymoron. How are you crafty and then dumb at the same time?
Maybe not intelligent, but maybe it's mischievous. Yeah. Maybe it's mischievous, not crafty.
Animal cunning.
Yeah. That kind of cunning.
And then they ate yam. So, interesting. Healthy too. Yeah, so they move around in packs of fives and six. Absolutely zero social distancing there. That's a big no-no.
A lot of people are actually asking about the Orang Pendek. Why is it considered a hantu? Or in someone saying that, you know, like if you say an Orang Pendek's a hantu, then maybe Bigfoot's a hantu.
Well, I consider all these cryptids, actually.
Yeah. I mean, there could be a physical animal, physical being there. But if you look at, you know, Tibetan law, if you look at the law of the First Nations people in United States and America, and even the Indonesians, depending on who you talk to, the focus of it could shift from it being a completely natural part of the ecosystem, just like a cryptid, like Eugene saying, to actually being a spiritual being. So I think the jury's out on that one for me.
Could it also just be a way for people to frighten others, like, you know, not stay out past a certain time, just like the tales you tell children, don't go out at this time because, you know, something's going to come get you. I find that it's always very fear-based. Stay away from this area. Or, you know, don't go out at this time.
Then again, I reckon if you're going to scare children, you would use a more horrifying, terrifying creature.
Not just children, but adults as well. You know,
I think that a Pontianak would be a tactic to scare people.
But I think I want you to think about this. Okay, this the pictures that were shown just now looked very much like a primate. Could be a monkey. It could be something that is endemic to that area, a case of seeing something and then attributing it to the supernatural, but it could just come very much from the natural world.
Actually, Sonia, in a place called Floriansis in Indonesia, they found the skeleton of a 4-foot-tall hominid. Like a legitimate animal, right? And so 4-foot-tall, and it actually kind of marries up with the stories and the folklore of the legend of actually small diminutive kind of people. So maybe this is a relic of our prehistoric past, perhaps. Or could it be the ghost of something that lived a long time before?
Sorry guys, actually appearing. We're a bit laggy. I think we're not moving at all.
I think this stopped.
Yeah.
We're plagued with a lot of technical issues today,
Did anyone bring the EMF reader?
Not sure why. Because this is a very interesting conversation along with the dissection of the previous story that I want to talk about, but we are not... YouTube is sending me an error message to say it's not receiving enough video to maintain. Maybe it's me because I changed video and then we're having this problem. So I'm just going to... Yeah.
It stopped.
You stopped entirely, right?
Huh? Yeah, it's frozen. But if you guys can still comment in the section, please explain to everybody what's happening.
No, you stop start, then we end up having two different videos again. Do we want to stop start? But then we lose all our...
The audio is just fine. So
yeah,
it's the
video.
Let me see. Maybe it's me.
If the audio is good, let's just keep talking. Joe, type a couple of things in if you can, perhaps, you know, explain what's going on. But they can hear us too, so
okay.
A bit of interaction.
With your very noisy mechanical keyboard, please.
Yeah.
Here we go.
Chilla, chilla.
Press hard, hard.
Press hard, hard. Okay. So
the audio is fine. Still... Just keep going. I agree.
Yeah, so we are still trying to fix that part up, so do bear with us for a while.
So if anyone is interested, type in Homo floriensis. That is the term of that hominid that was found in, I don't know, was it Sumatra? It was in Indonesia. It was an island of Indonesia.
Sounds so, like it's from Flores. Is it from the Flores Islands?
Yes. Well, where is that? That's in Indonesia, right?
That's Irian Jaya, isn't it?
I'll let you know. It is. There you go. In the island of Flores in Indonesia.
Yes. So yeah, I've been to a place that's near Flores. It's called, I can't remember. I've been to this place. It reminds me of Bali 30 years ago. And from there, I stayed a night and then boarded a boat to the Komodo Islands.
Right. So there you go. And I mean, there's a precedent for this, right? So I'll read it out. Homo floresiensis is a species of small.
People were very small.
They are small, yeah.
They were small.
It's a species of small archaic humans that inhabited the island of Flores in Indonesia until the arrival of modern humans about 50,000 years ago. The remains of an individual who would have stood 1.1 meters in height were discovered in 2003 at Liang Bua on the island of Flores in Indonesia. So there you go. Mm. It's a hominid.
Okay.
The island, so where I landed, it's called Labuan Bajo. And it's just across Labuan Bajo. That's where I landed. And then it's very near Flores. So the ikat that I bought.
Yep.
I have another piece that I use for my bed. That's from Flores.
Are there any motifs in it that are perhaps similar to the cryptid that we've talked about today?
No, there was not. But when you mentioned that, I got very excited because I actually know where that is.
Where Flores, there you go.
Should I leave the stream and just let the two of you talk? And
yeah, see you later, Kim. Bye-bye.
Have a good time. Wow. Okay, okay, bye-bye. See you next week, guys. Bye-bye.
I remember us talking about this, Kim, like many episodes ago, and I talked about the Orang Pendek, right? Have you managed to talk to any of your Dayak friends about the Orang Pendek or the little people in Sarawak?
Yeah. Actually, not in Sarawak, but I didn't get to talk to any of my friends. Although, I've never, like, even the friend that have been in and out of the jungle working for the forestry, right?
Yeah.
He never mentioned this part, even though we are borders of Indonesia, but we never heard of that part. I mean, like, well, yeah, we are not in Sumatra, but he never mentioned about that. He never mentioned about that. And when I did my research producing the Know Your Hantu segment for tonight, I've never came across a writing that is mentioned that this Orang Pendek or Orang Kecil exists anywhere else apart from that island.
Right.
So okay. It could be, again, like whatever you guys mentioned earlier on, it could be very small creature that looks like monkey, you know. It could be a very small, like one of our audience mentioned just now. It could be, you know, something that has not yet evolved properly. I mean, there's a lot of possibility, I would say. Yeah, I could not sum it up, but I produced this episode is because Joe asked me to search more on Orang Pendek or Orang Kecil.
Yeah,
and because I bumped into this story, right? The story was saying that although this story happens in Singapore and it's not in Indonesia, but the 150 centimeter in height kind of like, you know, bring me back to like, oh, hey, Joe wanted to do this episode and let me search more on that. So but the thing is, when I am searching for about it, yeah, I am actually quite on the side of that it's actually something from the nature and not something supernatural. But then again, I've never seen that thing, right? So how would I know? I mean, like, for Indonesian, they believe that it is of the supernatural being.
In Western Australia, it's known as mummeries or wudachis. And the interesting thing is that in our fauna, I don't think we've had any, like, hominids or anything like that, you know, like orangutans or gorillas or stuff like that in WA. And, you know, stories of the little folk, like, you find that in the United States, you find that in Ireland, you find it in Norway. You know, the idea of sharing the natural world with a diminutive folk, you know, is not something that's just in Asia. It's worldwide.
So case of, you know, mistaken tribe or something.
Possibly, very possibly.
Yeah, possible. So Eugene now is back on. Hopefully, yeah. It doesn't lag as bad anymore. But
this orang pendek and the hominids and the cryptids that we talked about is not quite the same as the little people confession that confessions.
Yes.
Still lag. I'm still lagging apparently. Okay. Yeah. But yeah, what are your guys' thoughts on this one? Child spirit, perhaps, in the tuition center, spirit of unhappy children, and the energy just sits out.
Toyol is out to get tuition fee la.
Tuition centers are scary enough without ghosts down there and study and having to complete your math homework on it. Your teacher pulls your ear, slaps your face, right?
I never do that. I don't believe in any of that. There's so much more that you.
That's
can
how we can now. When I was young.
You're a bad boy, terrible student.
I just didn't have the mental ability for like maths and all that kind of stuff. But so the story that you know of the tuition place, right? It sounds more like shadow people. I don't know what you guys think about that. It sounds more like this person encountered what is usually known as a shadow person.
The shadow people phenomenon is actually a very common thing, right? What's a bit of background of the shadow people, Joe?
So basically, you know, people notice these shadows that are moving that is blacker than the night, blacker than the dark that it's around them. Rather than a shadow against the wall, they seem to have some substance and shape. And what people kind of think they are, they are usually seen as quite negative. And at the same time, seen as these, you know, like almost like a tulpa kind of thing that hasn't got shape or form yet, but will take shape and form when they come in contact with our fears. So again, like, you know, different places where we'll talk about them differently, but shadow people known all over the world, all over the world.
Yeah. There's actually this a story that was sent to me today. Actually, it wasn't just a story that was sent. It was a phone call. I got a phone call from someone who shares something similar about seeing things running around. So when we talk about things, small things running around, automatically people would think toyol or the Thai kumantong. But in this case, what is this little people phenomenon? It's just very coincidental because I did not plan this conversation with Kim about little people around Pendek. But yet there has been a spike in phone calls and messages coming to me about people seeing little things running around.
Wow.
So in this case, it was a family with a Indonesian maid who has things that goes missing. And it seems to the family that the wife will find things missing or will have things whispering to her ear. And she keeps seeing this child spirit. A spirit of a child. So she keep thinking that this could be her aborted fetus or her. And when she went to a spiritual practitioner, they say, oh, this is actually the spirit of a child. So for many years, she embraced this child spirit as if it was her own. But only later on to realize that she keep having miscarriages after miscarriages, and she attributed it to maybe my child spirit doesn't want me to have another kid. So a lot of it is based on her belief that this is a child. But later on, I did not get to this point about how she found out. But eventually she found out that it was actually her maid trying to kill her So that she, because the husband and her and the maid is having an affair.
Don't do black magic, people. Do not do black magic.
That one has got, that one is all human emotion taking over already. Nothing supernatural.
Yeah, but she doesn't believe that her husband would do such a thing, right? And says that it's only due to magic that he would have fallen for charms. And here's the thing, right? We talk about maybe it's human psyche. When she searched her mattress after, you know, when the maid went to market, she found artifacts, she found hair, she found photographs, she found things being tied together. She found vaults of liquid.
Yeah. But let me tell you something about human behavior. This one, Joe, you think about it as well. You probably have a lot more to say and a lot more observations. You know, this whole thing about maids and men, if the men are adequately looked after by their wives, would their husbands even stray in the first place?
Likely.
It's like, why do we have to blame everything on black magic? And why do we have to blame everything on the other woman? Why can't it just be pure human emotion?
Lust.
Not even lust.
Need. Just need lust. For...
I mean,
no, I just don't.
The need to have sex is a very, it's a very primal, the very primal drive.
I was going to use the word primal. Yeah.
Yeah, it's a very primal drive. So certainly, if we want to look at, you know, take it from the perspective of, this is just, you know, a case of, you know, two people meet together and they, you know, they fell for one another. Certainly, you know. But I'm just thinking there's a little bit more to it when
there is a little bit more to it. Because if the wife is not looking after the husband and somebody else is paying attention to that husband, then he's definitely going to stray.
Yes, definitely. However, you know, with this story that Eugene's talking, you know, when you start pairing that up with people having these kind of, you know, little sightings of little shadows, and then you find stuff under there, then it maybe lends a little bit more weight to it. But could this be a simple case of, man meets maid meets man? Wife goes out to do the shopping, maid and man go into the bathroom. Possible. Totally possible, right? Yeah. In fact, I saw this video once on... Oh, no. No, I can't talk about that one. No, better not. That's all right. Done. No.
You can send me the URL later. I'm just asking.
Yeah, I'll do it.
I'll send it to Alvin later. Just send it to me.
Research. Yeah. What a story.
Keeps keeping quiet. He's like, oh,
his mom's gonna, dinner is tomorrow, right?
Yeah, mom's dinner is tomorrow. I'm not gonna. I'm giving you an hour and a half to repent a little bit so that I don't have so much to say about you. But you still went full on URL, Pornhub, and what shit.
We didn't say Pornhub. We did not say Pornhub. Yeah. What is Pornhub? No. Eugene, do you know what Pornhub is?
I think it's the router, lah. You know that you have.
No.
I don't know.
It's a different hub.
Right? I don't know.
Yeah. Wi-Fi hub extender.
Porn hub. You know, people go porn fishing.
I'm Pornhub. The hub is spelled HUBB. It's a hub for people that is with a name porn in Thailand. Like, you know.
Pornsak.
No one's buying it. No one is buying it, Kim.
I'm definitely not buying it.
Why?
Now you're gonna say hub? Hub is what short for hubby, is it? Now, is that what you're gonna say?
Or is it? Huh? Is it hub? Is it like hamsap? Like hub? Hamsap? No.
Excuse me, guys. You guys are gonna have dinner with my mom, or I'm gonna have dinner with my mom?
We can zoom.
After last week, I am not having a dinner anywhere near your mom or you or that conversation, bro. No.
All right. Okay, let's get straight to the next confession. This one is Mount Alvernia. Before we go to the confession, for those of you from overseas, I know we have Korean fans here today as well. Mount Alvernia is a hospital, one of the many hospitals in Singapore. It is, I think, a Catholic-based hospital. Right. My own son was born there. I know Sonia was admitted there for dengue not too long ago. And Mount Alvernia has some stories, not as many as Tan Tock Seng, Singapore, SGH, especially not like Changi Hospital. But Mount Alvernia has some very interesting confessions that came out straight from the nurses working there. One of the confessions from before was that Till today, some of the nurses actually leave sweets around the hotel, the hospital, to appease the spirits. And that's still happening today.
I thought it was for me. So I went around picking it up.
Did you?
That's why I had to follow you back.
I thought it was a trail to this big heap of brownies or something. No?
That's the way to trick Sonia.
Hansel
and
Gretel. Did it
was the trail leading to a white van?
I saw that movie too on that other show on the website the other day.
That one, that thing.
The van. Yeah. Sometimes there was a taxi.
And okay. Then they exchange favors. Yeah.
So, I'm not gonna say anything because I'm gonna fail in the show.
I only picked up sweets. What is this van and taxi?
It's okay.
Sometimes it's a bus as well.
Oh yeah.
You know,
it's a proton villa, lah.
Why so small? I don't know. It's space, lah.
Flexibility.
Unless you date orang pendek, then can proton villa.
Okay. Sonia. Oh wait. Sorry.
Ah, mati dulu. Next story is Mount Alvernia. This one is by Anonymous and voice over by Sonia Corona.
Alvin, oh, lovely.
Mount Alvernia. It was a Tuesday morning at 3:45 a.m. when I had to rush my kid to Mount Alvernia Hospital and he was admitted. We were given a single room situated at the end of the pediatric ward. My baby was running a high temperature and I stayed awake to look after him. It was about 4:45 a.m. when I suddenly heard some knocking, or rather a banging sound, coming from the corner of the room. I brushed it off, thinking that it could be air pressure since the windows were facing the highways directly. The following night at 12:30 a.m., I once again heard the same knock, knock, knocking, banging noises. My baby was up, and he too heard the noise. I thought it might have been coming from the patient's family in the next room, and they could have been moving around, so I didn't pay much attention to it. And then, at 2:30 a.m., the noise occurred from the same corner, and I woke up, startled, with my heart racing. I pressed the nurse call button, with the intention of politely requesting them to ask our neighbors to reduce the noise. When the nurse entered our room, I immediately asked, "Is the next room occupied?" And went on to say, "Could you kindly tell them to reduce the noise? And I'd appreciate it if they can be more considerate." Her reply freaked me out when she said that there was nobody in that room. The patient earlier had already been discharged sometime in the late afternoon. Upon hearing this, I freaked out. I told the nurse that there were some noises coming from that corner, and she said it could be the construction work happening right outside of our window. I thought to myself, yeah, right. Construction work at 2:30 a.m.? Please check for me. Go ahead and have a peek at the window. Her expression immediately changed, and she asked if I would prefer a change in room, and I said, yes, please. I suggested to keep the door open and the lights on as well. Again, the noise reoccurred. I took my iPad and started playing some music to create a distraction. Time passed, and soon it was daybreak, and we were still not moved to a different room. The following night, my husband dropped by with some clean clothes and toiletries. I told him to check the corner to see if it was possible to place our bags there. He didn't seem bothered, but I was desperate to share with him the incident that had happened the nights before, and yet reluctant at the same time to scare him. I blurted out to him about the noises I was hearing, and instead of comforting me, he said, "Babe, don't bother about these noises, and you just focus on our child." I know he was frightened because he left the room at about 1 a.m. Right after he left, the noises started back up again. This time, I couldn't stand it anymore. So I pressed the nurse call button and begged them to shift us to another room. Thankfully, there was another available room and we were shifted immediately. Later, during the day, several nurses asked about my request to change rooms, so I told them about the noise. Out of curiosity, I asked if there were patients before us who had complained. And it was no surprise to me when she told me that there had been patients who have requested to shift rooms but never explained their reasons. Another nurse told me that several other few patients requested to change room, and one of them particularly mentioned that he was very uncomfortable in the room. Has anyone ever encountered similar incidents in this hospital before? Well, one thing is for sure, I would definitely avoid this particular room.
Did he say what room number it was?
Why, you want to go by 4D, is it?
No, because the room I was in was three something? I can't remember, but I mean, if you go into that hospital, everything looks so holy. It's hard to imagine that it's haunted.
Holy, as in it looks like a church.
Yeah, yeah, exactly.
It's a Catholic hospital.
It's like one of those mission hospitals.
So every floor you go in, there's like a saint something or a mother, sister something. And it just feels very holy.
My mom has a story involving my brother, and part of it is his admission to Mount Alvernia Hospital. It is Hantu-ish, so I'm trying to get her to confess.
Could you give us the Cliff Notes version of that story now?
Well, basically my brother got very sick, and it had to do with an artifact from Indonesia. He went to kind of Mount Alvernia quite a bit, and whilst there, mom had a dream about a monk and a huge bird that was attacking my brother. And when my mother, when a certain priest had come to conduct a blessing for my brother, a very powerful priest in Singapore, powerful, whatever, a very holy priest, mom had another dream where this monk attacked the bird and killed it. And the very next day, my brother's almost life-threatening fever just broke.
How do you explain that?
I want to know how you feel about having a little brother.
How do I feel about having a little brother?
Wait, what?
He's coincidental.
How old were you?
My brother's 10 years younger than me.
Ah. Did you resent your mom in any way for having him?
No. I wanted a brother.
Sonia is trying to study the psychologist here.
And I wanted someone to, like a playmate, and I wanted someone to have the experience of having a great bigger brother like I am. You know what I mean? So it's one of those, yeah.
Why did Eugene choke?
Good one.
Do you have any other brother before this 10 years younger brother than you? Do you have any other siblings between?
Right. Okay. So here's the thing, right? My mom suspected that I was a twin. There have been instances. I don't know if I imagine. I have to ask my mom. Where in a long distant past, when we're living in Singapore, they may have seen two of me. I don't know, something like that. I'm not very sure.
Turn around. Let me see the back of your
head. Have you seen the movie Malignant?
Does he have a parasitic twin growing out of the back of his head?
Maybe if I just press my fat together, it's like a mouth, like two eyes and a.
You should put googly eyes there. That'd be quite cute.
I'll do it next time.
What made your mom think that you might be a twin?
Not very sure. I'll have to ask. But I think it had to do with maybe some complications she had just before I was born. So I may have been the one that ate my twin.
I think one of our audience might have an answer for you, John.
What is with the fat shaming tonight? All right, okay. Look, I'm leaving.
Joe's not fat, guys. It's just the fish eye lens that he's using that makes everything
look exactly, bro. You know the camera adds weight to you, and it's the lighting, and then the bokeh effect at the back. This all contributes to the presence of bigness but in front of me.
Eugene is using fish eye lens.
No. Jojo, you guys, I need you to focus on the confession I'm about to tell you right now. You see a nice jawline here? All by design. For the angle of the camera and angle to the light.
My hair's all standing.
I thought he was using the contouring powder or something.
When you see me in person, you bump into me next time, you say hello, right? It's not like that. You'd be like, that's how you usually look like.
But bro, why do you think I have this? This clearly defines, my face. Or not? This is like a moon.
All of you are divulging all your secrets right now, is it?
Because Supernatural Confessions, fam who watch a live show, they are family. They get to know all our deepest, darkest secrets. And quite frankly, if you have been watching us for the last 6 months...
Then you always win Double Chin Challenge.
And thank you, Kang J-I-H-H. Hey, Grizzly Bear is not fat. That is correct. Thank you.
It's all muscle, is it?
In a short time or 6 months, I know more about Kim than most of my close friends I've known for 20 years. For one, I know Kim eats in the toilet while taking a shit.
Yep, that's true.
I also know that Kim has
all the fans know also.
Yeah, Kim has a cuckoo chow problem as well.
Yeah, and he almost destroyed his mom.
Destroyed
his mom.
That cuckoo chow problem is mom. When I was small. Okay, not now. Okay, or now that you say Kim has cuckoo chow problem, then everybody like, oh, Kim has cuckoo chow problem lah now. Oh,
he swam in a polluted river.
That's how rivers
laden with
Kim cuckoo chow.
And all he had was an allergic reaction. It was a
What is happening now? Why is everything coming to me when I keep quiet the whole night and it still come to me?
Oh my goodness.
Because we know it's fake. Don't pretend to be a good boy.
Someone say that.
He's just quiet because he's got dinner tomorrow. That's all.
That's correct. That is correct.
Oh my.
Otherwise, he'll be the first one.
No, also I have to keep a bit last because next week is going to be our final week, right?
Yeah.
And we're going to have our Ask Me Anything, right?
Oh, yeah. Okay, so next week.
I'm so afraid.
I don't want to die in the episode.
For everyone who's listening into us right now, next week is our final week for this season. We are taking a season break every year. October, Halloween, right? That week, we will do our last show and we'll take a break. And in that last show, after we end our run at 11:30, everyone is just free to go off. There's no more stories to tell you. There's no more show. Everything that comes after 11:30 is just all freestyling. We're just here. We just want to hang around, and you're invited to hang around with us. And whatever you guys post or whatever you guys ask, we will answer everything to the best of our ability.
Eugene will answer everything to the best of his ability.
Yes, he can go ahead and do that. I want to reserve the right to not answer because God knows what kind of questions are going to come up.
I know some of you are curious. I'll just give you one freebie right now. It's like the arm of a baby holding an apple. That's all I can say. But yeah, join us again next week where we'll be having a special show, a special goodnight show. When we come back in season 3, you'll see possibly some changes. We are trying to do some upgrades on the back end just to serve you guys. So that's it that we have for this week's confession. We still got some time, and actually, do we have a promo for this week?
Do we have promo for this week?
No, we don't.
No, we don't. I don't remember cutting one.
No, don't have. I'm looking at the folder right now.
But we can have Joe who talked to the confessor.
Yes, YouTube. Okay, I'll give the fans and family a bit of a rundown. So I met this guy called Roy, and he's an American that lives in Ubud in Bali, and I came to know him through several forums online. And when I was doing some research about a horror themed supernatural tour that we all have planned when the borders reopen, right? And he has got a lot of contacts there. He's married into a Balinese family, And so, you know, he converted to Balinese Hinduism, and he's really kind of, you know, he knows a lot about the culture. And he was basically telling me a story about an unseen village. So as he will explain, and I won't talk too much about that, there is this thing called Sakala and Niskala in Bali, which is a very big part of Balinese culture. It is the seen and the unseen, and they both live side by side. And so his story is about an unseen village in Bali.
That sounds like the Bunyan village.
You know what? When I had initially spoken to him 6 months ago, I mentioned it to him. He said, you know what you talked about? It sounds like, you know, the Orang Bunyan. And I think there are a lot of parallels between his story and the Orang Bunyan mythology of Indonesia. But yeah, Bali has got a really, it's kept its culture intact. It's got a lot of stories there. And he has put me in touch with a Balian, which is a Bali high priest or like a holy man, right? And again, like you know, I said when borders open, you know, we have something planned for members to take part in when they organize stuff.
Speaking of members to take part in, I have some good news for you guys. You have been with us since last year. You might remember this brand called Nocturne Noir. We did a promo with them last year for around a Halloween season. This year, Jason, the founder of Nocturne Noir, gave me a call again. I had lunch with him. He says, we love Supernatural Confessions. We always watch you guys and we want to take part, right? This year, we want to offer all your... I don't want to spoil the secret because it's a surprise for the host and for you guys as well. So we may pull up some promos. As he's not making a cent out of this, it's just we want to give something back to the fans and the community. So we got like a discount, and if you want to purchase a drink, there's a discount. And I was promised by Jason, he has not given anybody else this kind of deal. It's just for SE community, right? So that's a kind of love we have. On top of that, also want to say a big thank you to Shaw Theatres. Shaw Theatres invited Jonathan and I for a premiere of a horror movie called Under
One Roof. No.
Underwater.
Underwater.
Is it underwater or is it under
your stepsister? Oh my God! Kim!
Kim's back. Kim is back. Oh.
Why when I say that everybody keep quiet, then sleep in smoothly? When I say any other things, you guys are talking noisy.
Okay, I can't remember the title right now, but it's coming out in this year, 2021, in November. It's a horror movie about a lake, a house under a lake.
A house under a lake that's haunted.
Okay, there's the house, then there was like flood and everything, and now the house is submerged and the house is haunted. So there was like a pair of paranormal investigators that went down into the water, into the house to investigate for the YouTube views. And then shit happens. So I've talked to Shaw, and Shaw has given us 5 pair of tickets to give away. So that will be done next week as well. I'm not taking a single ticket. I would love to part with my money to support the cinema, to get them going. And basically, my point is I want to save every single ticket for the community. That's for you guys. It's not for me. So unfortunately, hosts, you guys pay your own and watch the movie. You have other surprises. But this 5 pair of tickets will be for the community, and we'll do something next week. You have a chance to win and watch a movie and maybe hang out together and, I don't know, wear your SC t-shirt when you guys go down.
Okay, before we go to the YouTube videos, I reckon that we pick up some questions because I've seen there's a lot of questions coming in.
Yeah, please, go ahead.
The comments. So, I saw, I think Nevin posted it twice. Nevin, sorry, we didn't get to respond the first time. So the second time he posted saying, SC meet and greet. And for the meet and greet, you can join Eugene for the movie. So pay attention next week, whereby he's going to give away 5 pairs of ticket to watch the movie Under, what is that?
I think the Deep House, someone said. The Deep House.
Okay.
Yeah.
Deep House. Okay.
Thank you, serious.
That can be the meet and greet. But once the border is open and it's safe for us to travel, once me and Joe get down to Singapore, we will let everybody know.
between them is called meat for meat. But we definitely want to hang out.
Or how about meet my meat?
Sure.
MMM. Yeah, you can have the meet my meat.
Okay, so we definitely want to...
I guess I won't be showing up for that one.
Yeah.
Why?
You got three of us to select from. We will... I believe in miracles. There you are. You
sexy thing.
Sexy thing, yeah.
I'll need the miracle.
Yeah, we definitely want to do a meet and greet. It's just that right now, with all the COVID-19 restrictions, meeting and greeting officially will just get us all in trouble. But we can all meet at the cinema and go, hey, fancy seeing you here. That's legal.
Yeah, Grace say, Kim, Malaysia open borders in November. Yes. But my situation is slightly different. It's because Sarawak don't play by Malaysian rule. We play by our own rules. So when Malaysia say open, our own disaster committee will have a say saying that not Malaysian, Sarawakian cannot go out. So we are still stuck. So we
have Sarawak like the Taiwan or China?
No, we are like Soviet Union.
Nobody says Joe and Kim can stay in the same room. That is the plan.
Joe and Kim can stay in the same room. Okay. I will hold the camera. I'll be the guy behind the camera.
Kimberly, is it? I don't know which Kim you're talking about now.
Kim.
Mrs. Ben. Dakota.
Hey, don't laugh, bro.
Joe wanna sleep with some Kimberly.
Come back.
So we got some time today. What do you guys have any horror stories to share? Not, I might want to share one more.
Sonia is very quiet after.
Yeah, Sonia.
Stepsister. I don't know why.
Sometimes, right, I don't know what the hell I get into with you boys and your boys chatter and stuff. This teacher disapproves.
Okay.
Is there punishment?
one of the things that I want to ask you guys, please vote in right now. I want to do something for our confessors for 2021. And this goes out to Sonia, Kim, and Joe as well. I want to be able to collate the winning confession. Not winning. I mean, all confessions are good. It's not competition, but your favorite confession that you think should make in the top 10 Hall of Fame for 2021. Last year, we had a top 10 Hall of Famer as well. And I think the number one prize, the winner was a guy from Malaysia. Who, if you remember the story about, he went to a apartment, he slept in a room in a mirror, and at night, there's this creature that came on top of him and goes, shh. Yeah, that was the winning entry last year. So this year, let's cast in your vote. Which confession do you think should make into the top 10 list? And what is your favorite? Send it to us in the comment right here or on Facebook group. We have a few ways for you to guys contact us. www.supernaturalconfessions.com. There you get my own WhatsApp number, my messenger there as well. Or you can go to our Must Be the Hantu Supernatural group on Facebook and then get connected with the rest of the community there and cast your vote. So we want to be able to put something together and thank this year's confessor.
Yes.
Mm.
But anything on top of your head now, guys?
Huh?
I said any confession that is on top of your head when Eugene mentioned.
Okay. I thought he meant literally. Is there something on top of my head?
My God.
But I'm interesting. Eugene was talking about a story that he wants to share with us.
Oh, yeah.
Okay. I'll do a quick one, right? This one is actually coming out on National Library Board for their Halloween special. Oh my goodness, my camera just went off again. Okay, you guys have to just deal with me without the camera right now. You can hear my voice still, right?
I can.
Yeah, I can hear your voice, bro.
Okay. This one is a quick one about a doll that came to life. And it was a doll from Bali, because you mentioned Bali just now, so I thought I would bring this story up. Someone brought a doll back from Bali, and this doll, it's not just any normal doll. It's one of those dolls that was used in a dance. Those Indonesian dance. Mm. Yeah, except this doll is actually the doll of a Rara Antank and Jaka Sega from it's like a local legend, and they would create these dolls and they would perform this legend. And before the dolls actually go into the performance, there'll be a medicine man who will come to pray over these dolls to ask for permission before letting it go onto stage. So one of the tourists actually went down to the shop to buy a tourist version of this doll, a handmade doll. Mm-hmm. So it's quite pricey. The doll maker would craft it out and then sell it for a few hundred dollars. They brought this doll back from overseas to Singapore and they put it on the shelf. But every night, the doll started moving on its own. So I was invited to go down to investigate, and I set up my motion sensor, my night vision cameras. And we managed to, the thing triggered the motion sensors. When we ran out to go and check it out, we found the doll sprawl in the middle of the room.
In the middle of the room?
Yes. It moved from the shelf to the middle of the room. So if you say that a wind blew the doll off the shelf, how could it possibly be when everything else on the shelf was as it is?
Was it placed properly on the shelf? Was it situated, like, was it leaning against the wall? Like,
So when I was there and I saw the doll, it was propped up nicely. It was not in a manner that would fall. Even if it did, right?
If its weight shifted or something.
It would have fallen maybe at a shelf, not in the middle of a room. Like, how did it flew in the middle of a room? That's one of the story. The second story we have, and all these three stories actually will be created into a mini graphic novel that we released anyway and as a podcast. But I give you just a Cliff Notes version. The other one was when I was invited to go down to Johor Bahru, to a house in Johor Bahru, and it was the entire block was haunted.
Wow.
And this one, the case that I handled, was about a lady, a nene, that was sitting or squatting in the corner of the ceiling, looking down. So the kid could see the thing. The mother did not believe. When the mother was watching television one day, she said, how come there's hair on her shoulder and on the couch? Because nobody in the family had long hair. And then when she was changing channel and the screen just went dark for a bit, she saw, for that split second, something sitting at the spot where the child was sitting.
Right.
Yeah. I'll just leave you with these two for now. So save some of the surprise for late for next week.
Maybe maybe the SC fans, when borders open, can invite us to their house, which is really, really haunted, and Kim and I will go and have a look.
Yeah.
Who?
Kim.
Auto volunteer him.
Joachim, then. Exactly. Let the Hantu hunters come and take care of it.
Wait, you know I am not your twin, right? I never came alongside with you in your mother womb.
Are you joined at the hip?
You never came alongside with him in your mother's womb. This is the reason why we're going to get cancelled one day, guys.
That's right.
when it's all taken out of context.
Sonia disapproves. Look at that. Chikgu face. That is 0/100 on the paper. Confirmed.
Anyway, 11:30, we have the premiere coming up. Niskala, the Unseen of Indonesia, is happening at 11:30. I think let's all say goodbye, and I'll post up the link right now.
Yes. Mm-hmm. And the question coming in asking whether Alvin is going to now Joe.
What the fudge?
Asking whether Alvin is going to join us for Ask Me Anything or not.
Yeah, but it shouldn't because it was fully charged today. I can see that.
It's your twin, Lajo.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, man.
We're plagued with so many technical issues today. I wonder why.
I won't speculate.
My stream is perfect.
Yeah, what did you bring? Yeah, you...
I'm the last one in. I was late for sound check. And my stream is good. You guys can hear me fine.
It's an STD, spiritually transmitted disease.
Bravo. I'll give you that.
Thank you very much. Thank you.
Now, can you spare me from visiting the haunted house.
Okay, I come back. Come back, time to say goodbye.
Okay.
All right. Anyway,
let's say the goodbye now before everybody. Goodbye.
Okay, Joe. Yeah,
before it.
Joe.
Yeah,
go.
My name is Joe. I am from Perth, Western Australia, and I always say there are always more questions than there are answers. Thanks for tuning in tonight, guys. Before I disappear into the void.
Into the black he goes. Wow, perfect timing.
Look at
Sonia.
Fade to black. I'm Sonia, and I believe that there is a super rational explanation for most everything.
Okay, hopefully we will be able to bring Alvin in the Ask Me Anything for next week, yeah, because we are teamed and he's supposed to be here as well. And once again, we're going to release this as a version of podcast every Monday. And Wednesday, we're going to have another episode, but that has yet to be produced. And hopefully, you're going to like, I'm going to put up something new, and hopefully, you're going to like that something new. And also, we have already now passed 100 episodes of our podcast. Yay! So thank you very much to everybody that supported the channel and the podcast, and thank you very much. So we will see you next week with a lot more longer sessions and whatnot. So I'm Kim, thank you very much, and whatever you don't see doesn't mean it is not there.
You know, my name
it
is
just
Eugene
means it somewhere else.
My name is Eugene Tay, and for everything that you cannot explain, simplest explanation is it must be the Hantu. We'll see you guys next week. Tell all your friends, join us for the final episode of the season of 2021. Now go straight go straight and watch out the premiere. See you guys. Bye-bye.
See you guys. Bye.
Ciao.
What did you find? You are listening to Supernatural Confessions.